and database and back-end and front-end programming. What whenever we were talking about this site, so often a lot of people just need to make a small change. And if your theme doesn't necessarily come with all these buttons that change the color of the font or the hyperlink or something, you have to go into the style sheet to do that. And so if you don't have a theme that lets you do that, it's actually pretty simple once you learn how to do it. And so I really wanted to do this session to empower people to start dipping their toes into just a little bit of code. So Jeremy's going to help us with that.
Thanks, Carol. Yeah, my name is Jeremy Saxey, like she said. I'll show you really quick because after this, if you want to see some of my notes or learn a little bit more about CSS, at the last WordCamp, 2013, I presented, I did a Friday class on CSS, and so I'm going to actually go into those slides for this class, but just to read two of the slides. This isn't a demonstration about CSS or anything like that. It's more about WordPress, the inspector tool, and child themes, and kind of putting, how does that work together? So this is, we're not going to be doing a lot of advanced code or anything like that. It's just kind of putting those together so you can get started on changing whatever theme you currently have in CSS. So here is my company website, and then, like she said, I'm from WebGuys, and the website is webguysaz.com, and then over on the right here is my blog for my company, and I'll just bring it up now. Over here on the right side is this link right here, and this is the presentation I did at WordCamp on CSS for Beginners. So I'm going to click that, and it takes you to the blog post I made about it, and then there's a little video there, 45 minutes, and then I'm going to the slides while you can use them a little bit, like I said. Okay, so that's a brief introduction to me. Okay, first, if you want to change the look and feel of your website and you have some theme installed, what you want to do is install or set up a child theme. Can anyone tell me what a child theme is? How is it different from another, just any old theme? What's a child theme?
It's dependent on the parent.
It's dependent on the parent.
Sub theme.
Yeah, it's like a sub theme.
Sits on top of underneath,
whatever. Yeah, on top or underneath, whatever you want to think of it. Yeah, it's kind of it's a subset of whatever theme you currently have active. So you have some theme active, and then you set up a child theme, which we'll do, and then there you can safely make your modifications. So why do I say that? Why do I say in a child theme you can safely make your modifications? Why would you want a child theme? Why does this concept even exist?
It doesn't get wiped out when you have your efforts.
Right. If you go and you have some theme installed, and then you make all these changes, then that theme comes along and updates itself. As soon as you update that theme, what the theme updater does is it completely deletes the theme folder and all the files, and then it reinstalls that brand new version of the theme. So it's all fresh again. Anything you've changed is now gone. So that's why the concept of child themes exists in WordPress. It's because it's a way to modify a theme without touching the theme's files. So that's child theme 101. Or changing the design of your site 101, whatever you want to think, however you want to think about it, never touch a file within the theme itself. It's going to get wiped out as soon as you update. So, go ahead.
So, this is outside of the world of like Genesis, stuff like that that has built-in frameworks, whatever, parent themes that come with them. They're designed to be used with only the child theme.
Yes.
That kind of takes care of itself, right?
They're basically doing that step for you.
Right.
And so when you make the changes, you're only changing the child theme.
This kind of has more to do with you're just getting, what I don't call a standard WordPress theme, not part of some framework.
It applies no matter what. It's just that Genesis, they're correctly using child themes. And so you're only modifying the child theme so that you can get updates from the parent theme. They can put all that good functionality in the parent theme. Know that nobody's going to mess with it. You're going to safely update it. So they just set you up on the right path. And so they're just doing what we're doing. But if you're not using a Genesis theme, you're using any other theme, then I don't like frameworks a lot because I'm a developer and pretty much get in my way. But if so, I typically am not working with the theme that already has a child theme. But yeah, it's true. If you want to go look at Genesis themes, I know Carol likes Genesis themes. If you want to look at their themes, that'll be a child theme. Okay, so as far as child themes are concerned, what makes them what's unique about a child theme that a parent theme doesn't have? How does that let's think about it from the standpoint of the structure of a theme on a website. Let's look actually. Okay, so here. This is just demo website that I set up. It's a brand new install of WordPress. Nothing, not a single thing has been done. Just I created the site and I installed WordPress and created my own admin account. So I'm logged in the admin account and here's just the default theme that comes with WordPress. So we're gonna go to the themes here on the back end and you'll see that that is one thing I did. I deleted the extra thing because I wanted it to just start. We only have one thing. So we have the 2014 theme active that shows that it's active. This is the only theme we have. It shows there's only one theme right now. Where does this pretty image right here and this name and this version number and who it comes from or who it's made by and description, where does all that come from? Anybody know?
The theme files, isn't it?
Functions.php. Which file in the theme? And the style.css. So we'll look at that in a minute. But what WordPress does is it looks at the style.css file. It has to be named exactly like style.css. So everything has a style.css file. And at the top of that file are some comments in the code that give this information. So it has to have the exact comments in that exact same way for WordPress to be able to keep this information. So it says, I don't even remember the exact names off the top of my head because I was just copy and paste it. But as something like title or something like that. This is 2014. It says author. Go ahead.
So the styles determines the size of the font, whether it's going to be right just high, just high, scrolling there.
Typically, yes. So. Backing up a little bit, just in general, the styles.css file usually contains all of the different styles that apply to theme itself. So, maybe I should have mentioned that. They don't have to reside in that specific file. They can reside in other CSS files. It's just, in WordPress, a theme has to have a file called style.css, that exactly, and then at the top of that, it has to have that comment block with some certain comments there in a specific way, and that's how it gets this information. So we have to know that because we're going to create another theme. It's going to be a child theme, but we have to have a folder on the server next to the folder for this theme, and then it has to have a style.css file in it, and then it has to have comments in a certain way in order for WordPress to say, hey, there's another theme here and here's its information. So that's why it's really. So one, our child theme has to be in a folder with a style.css file. It can have, if all you're changing is a couple of styles on your parent theme, then that's the only file you'll need for your child theme. You'll just need that style.css and you can start putting in your styles and the one. You're changing stuff and there's nothing else you have to do. With child themes, there's a couple of things that are unique. So I'm just very briefly going to mention these other things. In WordPress, you know, all that functionality that goes with your website that the theme gives you, you know, the pulling in all the blog posts, pulling in the widgets, all that stuff is done by the theme. When you create a child theme and you activate it and you only have a style.css file, obviously it's reading some files from your child theme, and it's reading the other files from your parent theme. So one thing that's unique with child themes, if you needed to change any other files besides the style.css file, you copy the PHP file from whichever you wanted to change. Say it's the header of your website, the header.php. You go into your parent theme, see that header.php file, you copy it, and you paste that file into your child theme, and then you start making the changes to the header.php file in your child theme. So you're still never touching any of the files in your parent. And so what WordPress does with child themes is it goes to the child theme folder and sees what files are there. If there are any duplicates in the parent theme, it ignores them. It knows, hey, I've already seen this header.php file in the child theme, so I'm not going to load the one that's in the parent theme. That way you can make modifications to the parent theme, including the PHP files and everything, in a safe way. Now when that theme updates, it'll get a new header.php file and all of its other files, but it doesn't matter because your header.php file is safely tucked away in the child theme.
Just a quick question.
Yes?
If you've got a file that's down two or three folders deep, do you have to maintain that structure?
Yes. So the question was, if your parent theme has a couple folders within it, say it has like a templates folder or an includes folder, and then it has some PHP files in there, if you wanted to, like, I like elegant themes, and they typically have an includes folder, and then they'll have like a breadcrumbs.php in there, and then there's the little breadcrumbs that are, I don't know if you guys know what those are, but breadcrumbs that are on top of a lot of websites. If I wanted to modify that, you do have to create that whole folder structure. The file and the folders have to be the same in your child theme. So I would have to, in order to change breadcrumb.php, my child theme, I would have to create an includes folder and then copy the breadcrumbs.php file into that includes folder. That's the exact same. Because just like on your regular computer, you could have a file called, you know, hello.txt. And then inside of a folder, you could have another file called hello.txt. You have the same file name. So in order for it to be considered the same file, it has to have the same name. So.
Can you pop that up at some point?
Yes.
The file part?
Yes. Oops. So the one exception to that rule, that if there's duplicate files in the child and parent theme, that it doesn't ignore the parent theme file, is the functions.php file. That is the one file that is unique. And what WordPress does with the functions.php file is, if you have a functions.php file in your child theme, it reads that file first, and all the functions that are in there, and then it goes to the parent theme and reads all the functions in that file. So that one you don't overwrite. So we won't get into more details than that. That's a whole other topic. But I just wanted to mention, trying to understand child themes here, so I'm trying to kind of understand how they work. What are we dealing with? And if you're dealing with, if you ever did need to go into the functions.php file and change something, if you see a parent theme that their functions don't have this PHP code that says if, and then the little exclamation point function exists around their functions, then they're not being good theme developers. They're not making their themes child themable in a very easy way. That's what's required for you. That's just all I can say about that. You can get a theme to that a lot. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and create a child theme first. Right? But Carol led me on to a plugin, and we're going to cheat and use that plugin to do it, but I'll show you the files that it creates. So we're just, it's going to automate the steps for us, so we don't have to mess around. Manually so, okay, so we're going to go to plugins, and we're going to add a new plugin, and it's called one-click child theme, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty sure it's just one-click child theme. I think it's hyphenated, but it finds it anyway. So one-click child theme, I'm going to look for this plugin, and it's right here, right at the top. So we're going to install that, okay. Then we're going to activate that plugin, and okay, so now that theme, or that plugin is installed with our other default plugins that are there.
Is that making a new folder then at that point?
Well, in the plugins folder, yeah, but not, okay. It hasn't done anything yet to the website. We just activated the plugin. All that did so far is here under appearance, when we go there, there's now a new submenu item called child theme. The plugin just added that for us.
Yes.
So we're going to click on child theme, and it says give your theme a name. We're going to call it, let's just call it child. I don't know if that's a good name or a bad name. I used to name it whatever the parent was, hyphen child, but at the end of the day, there's only a child theme. It's only the child of one parent ever. And there's only one theme active at a time, so I just started calling it child because there's only one possible child. There's only one possible parent at a time. If that makes sense. So we'll just call it child, and then we'll, in the description, you can put whatever you want. You can name it whatever you want, but we'll put child of 2014. Sorry, I'm typing one-handed here because I'm holding one. So, child of 2014. Okay, that's what we'll call it. There's my name, and we'll put create child. And I don't know if the plugin hasn't been updated in a really long time, but it still works. So I don't know if this ugly code that it spits out was supposed to be like that, but it works.
I noticed that too. It didn't used to do that.
Okay. I don't know what it used to do because it's always done this for me because I just learned about it recently. So it says theme switched. So what that just did when I clicked create child theme, it created the child theme for me, and it activated it, too. So we're already active. So now we'll go to themes, and you'll see active is child, and 2014 is now off to the right. And there's two themes up there you can see. And So I'm not going to do it right now, but after that, you're done with that plugin. It's done its job. So you can go back and deactivate it and delete it. Hope it's not needed. So now we're going to go to our So here's what was on the server. This is what was on the server. This is my local computer. I'm going to pull the files from the server in a second. So here's the 2014 theme that was there and all of its files and all of its folders here. So we're going to go to the server and we're going to say, give us the next, let's get the updated files that are on the server. And so who can guess right next there to 2014? What's going to be the next? What's going to be the new folder created? What's it going to be called?
Child.
Right. Yes. And child. So now let's look in child. So what file or files do we expect to be inside of child?
Style CSS.
File.css.
File.css. Right. So that plugin, you'll notice when we go back, see this pretty picture. That's there, that's just like 2014. That's the screenshot.png file. This plugin just copies that file over to it. If you were creating your own and you weren't using this plugin and you don't copy that file over, that's fine. It just looks empty, like this add new theme. It's just kind of an empty space there because we have the screenshot of what your theme looks like. So that means that we're also going to have a screenshot.png file. And there we go. Style.css, screenshot.png, there's all that. All that X values of what a PNG file looks like from a code standpoint. And then this plugin also brought in this file as well, this RTL.css. It won't always do that. It depends on what CSS files are in your parent theme, the child theme. I don't even think this one actually needed to be included in it. It just the plugin's been thorough. So we'll ignore this for now. Plus, we're in America. We can delete it. Okay, so now in the style.css, so let's look at the style.css for the parent theme first, really quick. And you'll see all of these comments up top. This is how you start a comment in CSS, with the /*, and then here is theme name. There's the name of the theme, 2014. The theme URI, that's the link to your theme, the author, the WordPress theme, and all this other stuff. So, and then right here, that comment code, that comment block ends. That's the stuff in the style.css that's required. Not every single one of these is required, like you don't need tags, you don't need a license, you don't need everything there. I can't remember what the bare minimums are, but there's like a name, and I don't know what else is required besides the name. So now we're going to go up and look at our child theme.css, and here it is. See, they only put four things. So for a child theme, it does have one extra requirement that a parent style.css doesn't have, and that is this line right here. So here's a theme name, child, and then there's the description we put in, and then there's the author, what we all put in the plugin. The only thing we didn't specify was this, which is the template line. That template, right there, that 2014, not the bottom one, just the top one right there in the comments, that tells WordPress what the parent theme is. And that name is the name of the folder of the parent theme. Name of the folder. So that has to be exact. So that's right there, those lines create a child theme in WordPress. These lines above from here up, these ones right here, those create a theme in WordPress. This line right here makes it a child. So, and then you can see there, this plugin, they use the optional values. You can add and put in some of those other values to be more descriptive. Okay, so we've created a child theme. I'll come back to this line right here, but who can tell me why this line is here?
Is that the important?
Yeah.
It's bringing in the base style sheet.
It's bringing in the base style sheet. So why doesn't it just use the style sheet from the parent theme? Why do we have to bring it in? Yeah, remember what I said earlier about the only file that was unique in a child-parent theme relationship was the functions.php. Every single other file that you add to your child theme overwrites the parent theme, including the style.css file. So our style sheet was just wiped out when we created this parent theme. So this import line brings it back. So that we don't have a site with those styles. We'll talk about more of that in a second. Okay, now moving on. Let's go to our presentation now. We're going to talk about CSS really briefly. What is CSS? What does that stand for? Cascading style sheets, right? It's just a way to make websites look pretty, right? It's the code that gives the presentation. Who here is uncomfortable with what CSS is? Wants a brief explanation. Is anybody that something that anybody needs? Okay. Everybody's comfortable with what CSS is. So now let's go to really briefly, let's look at what CSS looks like. Okay, so here's a line of CSS code. Really briefly, I want to go over this because I think people, even me, do say these names wrong. So who knows what this whole thing is called? If you said this is a piece of CSS code, or to proper terminology here, so this is CSS what?
Yeah, declaration.
Declaration. Or? What did you say?
Rule.
Right. Okay. That's more accurate. That's a rule. The whole thing is a rule. Okay. So now we're going to jump ahead because we don't want to waste too much time on this, but here's the different pieces. That part right there, body, that's called the selector. That's the name of the element or the thing that you want to style in your HTML. That's the selector. So you kind of need these terminology down when you're starting to CSS, because you're going to be reading tutorials and it's going to say use this selector, blah blah blah, and you need to know what that is. That background color there is the property. That's the property that you want to change for the selector that you've chosen. That's the property you want to change. So on this one, the body, we're changing the background color. And then gray there, who knows what gray is?
The value.
Yeah, that's just the value. And then there's one more term here, sometimes that's used, and it's background color and gray together. What is that called? That's what we said earlier. Declaration.
Oh, that's declaration.
That's okay. The declaration. So because you're declaring what the selector is going to look like. So I guess that's what you translate that. So those are that's the different terminology there. And like I said, go to my blog and you can go to the link and you can see the slides. Okay. What does cascading mean? Why is it called cascading style sheets? What does that mean?
It's going from one, starting at one point, moving through the website down to the bottom.
Sounds like a waterfall, depending on the next, coming next.
Well, we'll go here to cascading. So Cascading refers to the order in which conflicting styles are applied. So there's a lot of conflicts that happen in CSS. Browsers are like super fancy. There's a lot of complex stuff. So say you say, I want all anchors, you know, all links on a website to be green. Well, if there's some link somewhere else that you want to be a different color and you reference it a different way, we're going to do some of this, then you now have a conflict. You're saying, links are green. And then the specific one, you say, no, this one isn't green. So no, it's a link. It's something else. That's a conflict. So which one wins? That's what the cascading refers to. It's the order in which styles apply. Which one wins? Which one takes precedence? So really briefly, again, this is in my old slides. I'm just going to say these really quick. But these are, this list I came up with on my own, out of my own head, because when I was trying to make this presentation last year, then all the definitions I found of the proper precedence for style sheets, they were all very different, how they were worded, and some of them even conflicted each other within the same website. So like, this is a mess. So I was just like, okay, I'm just going to use my own brain, and I'm going to try and describe it the best way I can. So maybe there's some holes in this, but I think it's pretty accurate. So how styles win, if you want to say, or which one takes precedence, is the first rule is it's the last rule definition. So whichever rule is defined last. So say you're in a style sheet and you said anchors are this way, and right after that you say, no, anchors are blue, not red. Then they're all red, because that's the last one that was defined. That make sense? So that's what rule one is saying. Whichever style comes up last wins. The next one is the more specific selectors take precedence. So what that means is, say you say all anchors are blue, but then you say anchors in the sidebar are red. That's more specific than just anchor. You're saying sidebar anchors. We'll show you the code in a second. But that's more specific. So that takes precedence over the rule that said anchors. And then the last one is this important declaration, which we won't get into. You might see that sometimes, but that basically says that trumps everything. It says, hey, this one's more important. And you might want to use that because sometimes certain styles are applied in weird ways, and your child can't be more specific, or it can't be defined afterwards because some plugin is loading some style after your theme is loaded. So sometimes you can use an import declaration to override that. So be careful with that, though, because if you ever do that and you start putting important everywhere, now you want to override those later, or a plugin wants to override those for its purposes, then you're creating all kinds of data. So I would say be very, very, very careful. Don't use it unless you absolutely have it. All right, that's it. Now let's get into the inspector. So let's get back to our website, and I guess the change I was going to do, this screen is so small that you can't even see it, so it won't. I was going to change the background of the website, but this theme has a background that you can only see off to the right, larger screens, and can't see it. So we'll change the background of this area. So with our child theme and with the inspector, so there's three ways to open the inspector. I'm using Chrome. It's in Firefox. It has its own inspector. It has its own web developer tools. Internet Explorer has its own too. I like Chrome. I think they're awesome. And so I'm using there. And so that's what I'm going to talk about. So there's three ways to open that inspector tool or that developer tool. One way is to right click and say inspect element. And then that brings up this inspector. This is crazy. That's what we're trying to say. That's one. Another way to do it is to do on, I don't know what it is on Windows machine, on a Mac, it's Alt Command I for inspector. And that brings up that same. That brings up the same one. And then that same command makes it go away. It toggles it on. That's the second way. The third way is to click this little button here, which is customize and control and Chrome. Click there. Just click on tools. And then you go to developer tools. And that tells you that little symbol there, just telling you all command I also does the same thing. And so those are three ways to get into the inspector. I do the keyboard shortcut periodically, but most of the time I do the right one. I do expect element. It's a quick way to get to the exact element that you want to change. So we want to change this kind of grayish color. I don't know what color it looks like up there, kind of whitish grayish. We're going to right-click on it, go to the inspect element, and we're going to see if we've got it. Okay, so here the inspector came up. On the left side here is all the HTML that is on the website. You can see that right there it has the line highlighted, div ID primary. So I'm assuming you guys know what HTML is, and that's a different topic, so we're going to have to leave that assumption for what it is and then move on to how those that HTML is styled. But there it's already highlighted on what I right-clicked on. That's the div. When I said inspect element, I was saying I want to inspect that. That's what I clicked on at the time. And then when you put your mouse over it, you can see it'll highlight that specific element, so you can know for sure that I have the right thing. We'll see that in action a little bit more here in a second as well. Okay, on the right side here, this is this is where you can see all the styles that apply to that element. So here you can see it has padding top 72 pixels. So I'll put my mouse over this again. See that green area up top? That's the padding. That's what that green is showing you. That's the padding. So that's 72 pixels tall. That's something you can kind of see how those two are helping each other, help us visualize what all this code means. And then here you can see the selector that is making that element styled. So the selector for this one, if you click it, is all this right here, the content area. Comma, we won't get too much into CSS here or too into the difficult stuff because we're trying to talk about a different topic or how that all comes together with WordPress and Challenge. That basically is two different things. I want that same style to apply to two different elements. So going down here, you can see in this inspector on the right side, in this styles tab, these are the things you can see. All the styles that apply to that specific element that is selected here on the left. And you can also see what file those styles are in. So this line of code right here is specified in this file. That's what that file is right there. So that's telling me where it is. So I'll put it, and you can see it looks like it's defined twice. I'm not sure why it's saying that. It's just that it covers two different lines in the file. So we'll look at the file and see that. But so there you can see the specific file that style is coming from, and then that number on the end is what line in that file that style is declared. So that's where the CSS rule is at, is on that specific line. And you can also click that, and it'll jump to that CSS file. See right here, it's showing you that CSS file. This is our parent's CSS file, remember? And here's the line that it's talking about. And there's the pattern. So you can see the actual CSS file, and it'll jump right to the line. Since we're doing child themes, again, if you want to get back out of this, you can click on elements. That's the name of the child theme style. So that's the other thing, files, and what line they're on, and the grid. And then this right here is in grade 2, so what that's telling you is that the one in black is the actual selector that's modifying that element. The gray ones are lines of their other selectors that apply that same style, but they don't apply to this style. That make sense? So it's telling you which ones are actually applying to the specific style, and which ones are put there. You know, just like when we go to the style sheet, we look there. That line has these other selectors up here too. It has this other selector, but we're not in the sidebar yet, or that content area. So that's the only one that's applying. This one is applicable to the element we're looking at. And then scrolling down a little bit, you'll see that there's another content area line and the padding top. All marked out, that's showing you the conflicting styles, and the crossed out ones are the ones that are lost. They didn't take that seat. They were not specific enough. They were declared earlier on, and then this one for another one came later and over it. So this one you can see it's in that same file, but it's on line 10-12 and same padding top declaration for content area, but then up here this content area was on 3512. So it came later. So, sense?
Go ahead. So can you get rid of some of those in your style, in your files? I know Genesis has a lot of that too.
What do you mean? You mean get rid of the conflicting ones?
Yes.
I wouldn't get rid of the conflicting ones because, again, you don't want to touch your parent data at all. So just leave it. Whatever that designer came up with, you're stuck with. You did a bad job. Okay. But conflicting doesn't mean bad. There's reasons for conflicts. It's just you need more specifics on that. And so that's a conflict, but so. It's like an override, yeah, because there's overrides for reasons. It's not like you only declare all, like here this. And the reason, too, if, actually, we'll skip that. We don't have a lot of time yet. So, yeah, and then also, so you can see all the styles that are conflicting that aren't applied as well. And then you'll see all kinds, if you keep, all the most relevant stuff will be at the top. Chrome is really good at putting stuff. But you can keep scrolling down and showing all kinds of stuff that's being applied that's just being inherited from other styles that are really general. They're not being overridden. So there's all kinds. So you can keep going for a long time. All the stuff that your browser had to go through and say, this is what this will look like, nobody can tell. So it's been a lot of complex stuff. So that's okay, so now we're going to change a couple things in the inspector and then in our style sheet. So let's change the background. So let's see, what's the background color of this primary area? If you scroll through, this is what you do. This is kind of the troubleshooting you do. You want to see what background color is applied to that area. You start scrolling down and looking for a background color. Background. There's a background that says green, but that's not being applied. That's being applied to something else. But here you'll see it's a pseudo element. It's getting into other stuff. It's not very specific. So what that tells you, if it's not really in the first area here, you start getting into this stuff, like pseudo element and that kind of stuff, then it means that the color that's being applied here is not, we haven't selected the right element. It's not, the background color is not being applied to this element. It's being applied to some other element above it. So we're going to click the next element up above it, main content. That here and see when I highlight this one, remember it had that padding above there, and then I go up to its parent HTML element and see it has that whole section is contains everything inside of it, including the padding for that last element that was just there. So now that's that whole area. We're gonna click that and see if there's a background. Yes. So and then another yes. Except for the troubleshooting that we're doing right now is we're kind of working our way from like the inner area to an outer area, so it kind of is helpful to click on the actual areas. But you can use this little magnifying glass here. When you click that, you can select an element specifically. Just start moving your mouse around and showing you what it's going to select. And say we want to click on this title, we want to see what styles are applied to this top. You can click it now, and then you'll see that it's selected again. And now we can see all the styles that are applied to that. So we're going to try and find that background color again. I didn't see the main content. So I honestly don't know where the background color is. So you're seeing me, this is how I work, like to look through it. So I'm going to say, OK, maybe it's actually defined at a lower level. Because when you go on primary, see how it extends all the way off to the left? But the background color we're looking at is a smaller area. So we're going to go down to the next thing below it, which is primary. Or content, sorry. We have primary. Now we're going to content. Click that. And I still don't see the background color. So where the heck is that background color? And then going down to article, you'll see that it's not even covering that whole area there. So it is, so you'll know that's too far down. Background color can't be applied to that area because there's a bunch of space in there that has the same background color. So that's fine. So I'm gonna go up to main content, that was how high I went before. I'm gonna go up one more to main. That's go to the top. Is that actually white, and I'm just not seeing it? It looks gray on there.
It's white. Yeah.
It could be possible that it's white, and that's why there's no style saying what it is, and so it's just turning white. So, like I said, I was going to give another example right after that, and it's not on the screen, so I can't see it. So,
that would be false.
If it's not defined, just click the button. So in the browser, it's that stuff. So what we'll do is we'll try changing the background color of this. And so using the inspector, I'm just going to click. What I usually do is I click on the item that I'm going to add a new rule. I'm going to add a new declaration to this content area, and we're going to have it defined. So what I typically do is I'll click on the last element there and then use my tab key, and that'll give you a blinker like in a new spot, so you can click something new. And I'm going to say background color, and it'll autocomplete for you. It gives you all the CSS stuff there, so that's why I develop all my CSS with vector tool, because it's really nice. And you can see what it looks like without actually. So I'm going to click background color, and then I'm going to tab, and we'll do. And there's what it blue looks like. So it looks like this inner element has a background color of input, that's why it's blue. So we don't want that to stay. We're going to do one other thing real quick. We're going to modify a different element. That's how you can see what it would look like. This isn't changing any file. This isn't actually changing. It's just seeing what it would look like. You're manipulating the website live and without touching the files with it. So I'm going to refresh, and you'll see that it's gone. So this is what the files are actually saying. So now we're actually going to change something. We're going to use Inspector Tool again, and we're going to change something, change in the file, and then refresh the pages and see that it stays. So what we want to change, let's do something a little bit fancier. This is getting towards the end of our application here. And let's say that this hello world, right now when you put your mouse over it, it turns green. Let's put like a little border around it that comes up when we cover it. That's not the prettiest thing in the world, but so right now you can see what I did right now, I used this little search tool, and then I just went and clicked on it. So see right there, see the little hand that's there? I'm hovering over it, and it's turning green, text is. So when I click it, you'll see here that this is showing A for the anchor, colon, hover. It's showing me what the color is when it's actually hovering. And I'm going to show you a little trick. This little button right here that says toggle element state, that's considered a state of the element. Is it hovered over state or is it not hovered state? That's the state that I'm in. So click this little thing right here, and then it shows you the different states that an element could be in. Yes. And this hover right here, you can toggle it. See, I toggle it on and off. See, it's changing green, and then now it's not green. Just like it is when I put it over my mouse over. So basically, that way you can see what styles are applied when it's not hovered. And you'll see down here the color that's applied is this 2B, 2B, 2B. Kind of like a blackish grayish color, and then when it is hovered, the color that shows up is just one. So that way you can manipulate the different states. So what we want to do, we're going to apply a style to that element when it's hovered. So remember, I click the element here, and then I tab, and then we're going to throw on a border. And then we're going to make that border 1 pixel, make it solid. And let's make it not. So that's the hover state, what it's going to look like. See, that's not hovered, that is hovered. So when you take that off and you put it, see, there it is. It's hovering, and that's what we're going to show. So we're going to do one other cool thing. We want it when it's hovered. We're going to make that thing rounded on the corners. So that is called border radius. And we'll do like 10 pixel radius. Now the corners. So now when it's hovered, it has this rounded border thing. And then we're going to do one other thing. Borders add extra space to the page. So you'll see that when it hovers, it moves a little bit. See that? We don't like that. That's a little bit goofy. So what we want to do is when it's not hovered, we need to give it a border as well. That's the same width. That's 1 pixel. But we don't want it to have a color, so we're going to say transparent. And we also have to specify solid. So now it's solid. So now, when you hover, it doesn't move. Just gets. So basically, when there's no hovering there, there is a border there. We gave it that extra little 1 pixel border that's transparent, so you don't actually see it. Now, when you put your mouse over it, So, not pretty. So what I do is I do this kind of stuff in, and this is what we'll do to wrap up. This is what I do to kind of inspect and play with stuff. I just do it in this inspector so I can see what it'll look like. And now I want to actually apply this to my website. So what I do is I take this selector and I copy it. Then I go to my child theme and I paste it. And then I get the style that I'm applying. So that we're doing the transparent border right now. It's really hard to put this border in there. So I just kind of copy and paste the stuff that I did. Okay, and then now we need the hover state styles. So I'll click back. There's the selector for hovering. There. Added a border. Yeah. I could do that. That's true. It does, but it sometimes it gets a little crazy, but that's true. You can just select it. Putting it in, it says I copy it. So that. Okay, so now I'm going to save this, and my little thing at the bottom, it uploads it to the server immediately when I save it. So now we've put those styles into our child theme. And now we'll refresh. And voila. Didn't change anything, and it's still there after refresh. So that's my job. Now, coming here real quick, you'll see that in the non-hovered state, the color that used to be, you'll see that there's a in the style that CSS, the parent theme, when I hover over it, it says 2014 style.css right there. That's what was defined before, just the color, which is what we did. But in our style sheet, I'll go and hover over there, CSS child/style.css. We added this border there. So both of those styles are being applied from the two different files. And then in the hover state, you'll see that the parent already gave it the green color, and then we added these two lines here. And that's basically it. Any questions? Yes.
Yes. Are you using the Sublime Text 2 to automatically update the
server? I'm using a plugin called SFTP that I learned from David back there. It's free, but it's like nagware, like Sublime Text 2 is itself. So it's free, but then it nags you every once in a while. It's like $25 or something. I just let it know. Any other questions? Yes. I don't. I end up using just Googling stuff, and then W3 Schools does have some tutorials that they'll walk you through a ton of stuff. But there are so many. You got to be careful because there's so many elements and so many properties and so many values that those properties can have that the basics that I told you there about what each thing is called, that's important. And then finding out what styles apply to each element on the page using the inspector, that's extremely important. But the tutorials, so many of them will just start talking about there's this CSS property and there's this property and they have these values and nobody memorizes that stuff.
Jeremy, there's an awesome book that I brought in. I forgot to bring it today. If you go to Amazon, it's just called HTML. If you go to Amazon, type HTML and CSS. And I wish I would have brought the book. You can find it on Amazon. It was the first one that came up. But it is very well presented. It's not overwhelming. It's not tiny print. It has lots of white space. It's just not overwhelming. It's a really good beginner's book. And they're coming out with one for JavaScript as well. So
if you learn code from books, well, check that out. I don't learn code from books. I mean, I did read about it. It's like, okay,
Yeah.
And you can actually see code. It's right. Seeing what it does. That's what the inspector tool is so great at. I mean, you can just start training all kinds of stuff.
That's how I've learned. I mean, yeah. The inspector tool is how I've learned CSS.
Yeah. What we told you tonight, like, it's good that Carol thought of the presentation in this way, because this is how most of us learn CSS. It's the quickest way. See what it does.
Copy it, you need syntax and everything, and you copy it right out. Change the value, and you're good.
Yeah, I love how, I mean, because it will suggest the syntax for you. When you're in the expect element and you want to add something, it suggests. Border radius, and when you start typing border, all of a sudden it knows possible radius or whatever. And so then you can just start playing and go, oh, well, I never heard of this one. What does it do? That's why you have a sandbox site. Everyone should have a sandbox site to play in.
That's why I like the inspector tool too, because you can get crazy with CSS and you don't have to touch any files.
Yeah.
So you can leave it on live site, mess around with all you want, not affect anybody else. You see it, but you can get everything just right or change it and say what it needs. That's not bad advice. You don't modify live sites like playing with them that way, but and that's how I learned too. If I want to see, like, I go to a website and I do something cool with CSS, okay, how do they do that? I just look at inspector tool and I see, oh, cool, they do this, I'm going to do that.
I think also a good tool, if you want to play with the CSS, is the one that lets you write the CSS in there. And the reason I like to do it that way is because if you don't like it, you can just erase it and save the file and the CSS is gone. But the other good feature is it keeps revisions of your CSS. So if you were to play with some CSS and you got to a point, you could go 5 revisions back and say, yeah, you know, I screwed everything up. Let me go back to how it was.
That's cool.
So you can go to the revisions of...
That's what I was telling you about the other day.
Scale. Yeah. One thing about that, I don't know Jetpack specifically, but a lot of those where you enter the code into a little text box, like Elegant Themes, they now have like a little custom CSS text box and you can throw it in there. I don't like those, to be honest, because it saves the styles in the database, and then when it outputs it on the screen, it outputs it on that page in style tags up in the header. It's not in a CSS file, and so it's not that. So that's why I don't like it. Also, too, is it typically outputs that CSS at the very bottom right before the head tag closes itself. So any style sheets you have are overridden by whatever styles are there. And Elegant Themes, I'm going to slap their wrist for this. I'll probably report it to them, but they just came out with a new page builder thing that's actually cool. But it outputs a bunch of CSS below, really low, below the child theme style sheet. So that I, on a recent project, I was on the phone for like a half hour with another guy that's helping me, and we had to figure it out together, but figured out that they were loading all these styles way late after a child theme was, and so that's not a child theme. That's bad. It shouldn't be. Parent theme should always be child theme, and allow child theme to run their styles really well. And so they need to fix that. So that's one of the things I don't like about the database.
Jeremy, you may have already mentioned this, but I found it really helpful to anytime I add some custom CSS to a child theme, I always put a comment about why I'm doing it, because before I did that, I'd make changes and then I'd come back and I'd see this long string of custom CSS and I'd forget. I was like, whoa. I mean, you can figure it out from the code, but it wastes time. It's a lot easier if you have a quick comment, if it's not obvious, you know, what you're doing it for.
A good thing about child themes I like is because it separates out the specifics of what you're changing from what was originally there, plain white. Because when you code CSS from scratch, especially if it's a really big project over 10 months, a project I've worked on before, over all that time, how many iterations of the project itself that you go through and how much the styles change ends up being CSS at that point. Overriding stuff that overwrites something. You can't. It's so hard to do. So child themes are nice because that style.css typically won't have very much in there if you're not customizing a lot. So it helps to separate that out in a good way. So like he said, use comments to help you remember what you want and stuff.
I'll just put it right above. Yeah, exactly. So I'll just say changing the border, changing the cover.
One thing I'll mention before we get to this plugin, each kind of thing that I'm doing. Does anybody know why?
Just so I can go back and see what
you see. Anybody know why that's bad? You want to pull it first because it's basically taking all the code from the parent theme style.css and plotting it in, right? So all of your stuff, afterwards, we're writing it because it remembers that order of what takes precedence. Your styles have to be after. The reason I don't like it is because it's very inefficient. HTTP is inefficient. I don't know why they designed it that way. But it's inefficient. All the files that it pulls, it makes a separate request to the server, each one of those files. So when you look in the header and it says, pull this JavaScript file, pull this CSS file, pull this CSS file, it can do those in parallel. It can make all those requests individually, and then it just waits for the response and pulls those in individually. But what this does right here with that, with this at import, it's inefficient because when it gets to that line, it's the request it makes is for your just your CSS file from the child theme. Then your child theme CSS is saying, hey, first load this other one. Because it's not its own file being requested on the server, it's a CSS file. As far as the browser is concerned, it's just loading the style.css from your child theme. But your child theme is saying, wait, stop, import this other style sheet. And that style sheet, you saw one of the lines was like 3,500 and something. It's a huge style sheet. So in HTTP, what that means is it's pausing. It's stopping what it's doing and waiting for that file to load because it's saying, hey, I need to load this style.css, and it can't load any other files. Well, it can load other files, but it can't load parent CSS and yours independently with separate requests. It has to just stop, pop, and wait for the whole parent one to load, and then it can load your attack.
So how would you import this differently?
So the other way to import it is the way that plugins do. I won't show you, but it's with WP NQ styles. And so if you want to look, that's how. So what you would do. I've even thought about, since this plugin isn't being updated anymore, it's been like over 2 years.
Take it over.
I was thinking of taking it over, and I'll load the style sheet for my So maybe I will, maybe I won't. But what you should, what it should do is create a functions.php file and not have this import line at all. Just have a functions.php file, and then in there, use WP NQ styles and NQ the parent's style sheet. Then have another NQ style, NQ trials, and such.
The codex actually uses the add import, I believe.
I know, all over the place, they use that add import. It's just super efficient.
Is that why sometimes you see like a drag and something loading? Like it's just a small pause? Or?
That's a really tough question. That's almost like saying, is that why things go wrong in the world? There's like a bajillion things. So when there's a pause, that can be like so many things. Yeah. That could be, it will add a pause. It will add a delay. But it's a delay for loading that specific that parent CSS file. They should be their own lines in the source code. They should have the parent theme CSS file loading and then the child loading independently. It's just that one will be first, the parent one will come first, and then the child one will come second, so that the child one will write the one CSS. That's how it should be done. I think we need to wrap up right now.
Yep, it's about time to move on. Thank you so much, Jeremy. Woo! So, are people's eyes okay? You're not rolled back in the back of your head. Everyone's doing okay? How about even the newbies? Are you still with us? No, we're going to need to set Lori up over there. So Lori, we'll go ahead and start. So now what we're going to do is we're basically going to do, what we call tips and tricks, idea swap. The power of community and the power of people working together is that no matter how much you know, you don't know it all, and someone right next to you may know it. And so that's where we want to leverage. So we always try and use this community and use this group to leverage some of those ideas, thoughts, and questions. So if you have a new cool plugin, if you have a new workflow, if you have a new system, or something really neat that you just discovered, please share. If you have a wish, a want, I wish I could find a plugin that did this. I'm needing something that will do this for me. Please ask. This is the time for us to just kind of swap those ideas and leverage each other and leverage the group. So, any tips, any tricks, any wishes, any wants? Mark.
Ultimate Tiny MCE.
Tiny MCE would not be my. We would direct that to. Where did Jeremy go? All right.
Is that
Tiny MCE?
Is that just for easy to use, or? Well, what I mean, what should we explain what it is?
Yeah, go ahead and.
It's basically what it lets you do. It lets you add a bunch of extra toolbar functions in the page editor, right? So. It gives you access to more fonts, colors and fonts, underlining things, just a whole bunch of formatting features, things that aren't there when you install WordPress. But I've always been nervous about using it because, you know, it's sticking in HTML, I guess, and that's going to get overwritten someday when I update my site or what's going to be. Sorry, is that an okay thing to use, or am I going to regret it someday?
Well, typically the things that are there. The buttons that are there, they're pretty safe to use because if you're putting it, it's putting some styles or something in line, but it's also actual HTML. So what's your hesitancy about using it?
Just mostly that when I update, you know, the site at some point, you know,
like update the theme.
Yeah, like when the theme gets updated or gets some update or something like that, but that stuff's gonna get overwritten.
Everything in that content box. It's stored in the database, so it doesn't get overwritten. Files get overwritten. I guess some settings to the theme system in general. So that's everything there is stored.
Now, short codes are a different story. Because if you get real short code heavy with your site, and you've got a short code in there and you change your theme, and the new theme uses a different short code. Then you're going to have like what you're talking about, the fear that you're talking about, and
that's even true of like Ivan's ultimate shortcode.
Yeah, I do too.
And they updated it on time.
Oh, did they break their own codes?
Yeah. And it was just a matter of going in and flipping the switch that said compatibility mode. Yeah. And it worked again.
We haven't had short codes in a long time. Do you guys know what we're talking about with short codes?
No, vaguely.
Yeah, we did short codes a while. It's been a long time, so that would be another good one. Yeah, I was like, Lisa Feist did that one, ages ago, over a year ago. Maybe we'll do short codes.
Well, there's my tip, that Ultimate Tiny MCE is really handy.
Ultimate Tiny MCE can be handy.
Does that let you edit more than just the widget area? Edit pages and posts?
Yeah, it adds buttons to the content blog. You know how you're, when you normally add a new page, adds buttons, so maybe you want strike through. Maybe you want highlight, WYSIWYG, yeah.
Big long list of buttons. You really nice way to add tables.
It's a nice way to add tables. Okay. Okay. So it's kind of it does some similar things as short code then. Than short codes, because a lot of the short codes do tables too.
Yeah, okay. I mean, it's got this enormous list of buttons you can have.
Uh-huh.
After you install it, you go look at this giant list and you basically check off the ones that you want to have show up in your toolbar and then you say, well, they're all that kind of stuff. But you could end up with an enormously long toolbar, you know, if you wanted to use all that stuff. You use, I don't know, 10% of everything.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm just curious if anybody's, are you using any page builders in your development at all?
I don't like them typically, but the one that Elegant Things just came out with, playing with it so far, it's kind of cool. And so it I think like page builders or frameworks or anything like that that's supposed to speed up, you know, what you're doing. The thing with those is they kind of tie your hands. If you use those, you can only do what they allow you to do. And so if you're happy with that, you're great. Also, too, if you become familiar with them, like a specific page builder or a specific framework, then once you're out of that framework, you might fish out of water. For me, from a development standpoint, a lot of times those things get in my way because they are limited to what they can do. They can be nice. So if they're limited in what they can do and they can't do what I need them to do, and I have to do it myself, then they get in the way. It's like I'm fighting that framework between me and WordPress and the way I see it. It's interacting, it's like in between WordPress, and so it just gets in my way. So
turning it over to a client. That's one thing that I think of when we're talking about WordPress and shortcomings and things like that. Where if you turn it over to a client, they can mess it up easier.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So,
exactly.
So the page builder that the Elgin thing just came out with, theirs is nice. It has a little button up top that says use page builder, mm-hmm. like that, and then the whole WordPress screen where you're modifying pages completely changes to the page builder, and then you toggle it back and you'll say use a default editor, I think, and it'll go back to WordPress. And so you can kind of toggle it. And then the thing with that is it's kind of the same thing. If you hand it over to a client and then they're using some page builder or some framework, you'll have to train them on that specific thing. And then to them, if that's the only website for everything that for, then that's great. But if they're changing or do a new website or whatever, they're not, it's not going to be clear in their mind what's WordPress and what's the theme framework that they're using. Because it's all intermixed together, so they're going to something else. So, but I mean, that's.
I just checked out the site board here. I don't know if you've seen that one. So, I just think that's a good way to help you. That's good for the site board. It uses the widgets that are already there and you can create it.
Very cool. Yeah, I think the page builders are really big right now. I mean, that's the next big thing that's happening. You know, the shortcuts ultimate that Chris mentioned. It's not quite like a page builder, but it's pretty close. When you look at all the short codes you can do, you just take the WYSIWYG editor right there, and you can build a whole lot of stuff through columns, tables, accordions, buttons, you name it. You can build it right there with the ultimate short codes.
That'll do everything a page builder.
It really will.
It's just a little...
It's a little less fancy.
Yeah, absolutely.
You have to short code it. I mean, so if you're comfortable with working in short code, it's fine.
And at least with that, then if you change themes, you don't have to worry about it.
Right, because Ultimate Short Codes is a plugin that can go to any theme.
You don't have to worry about the plugin.
All right. Other tips, tricks, wishes, and wants? Yeah.
This is it. Anybody listen to music on the Hilton Pandora, there's all these commercials. My hip hop cousin, Gary, and he had them present tonight, recommend Group Shark. I've been listening to the show for the
Hey! That's a workflow tip.
And then the other thing I want to tip on is I've been experimenting a little bit with Webpack's responsive slider. But does anybody have a favorite responsive slider plugin?
Or
a slideshow.
Anyone have a favorite responsive slideshow they use?
The one that's in
the native one? Galleries. The native gallery in WordPress.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I need a slide.
Yeah.
I use one, but I can't get the name of it. I have to look it up on the
Layer slider is one I've used. It's not free. It's really huge though. I mean, it's got a lot of bloat. It's a bloated plugin, but it does some pretty cool stuff.
Revolution slider.
Revolution slider?
I don't think it's free. Came for free right now. It does a lot of cool with the layer sliding.
The layer sliding is, yeah.
That's it.
Plus, one of the most popular plugins of all time is an extra. I don't know why I think so.
I was going to say, I've heard some people really unhappy with it these days.
You need some CSS
you have to. It's not responsive.
It was bought by Photo Karate. And Photo Karate owns it now. Or Photo Karate bought, Next Gen bought Photo, I don't remember what it is, but the two of them are working together and it's kind of gone down to any other? Yes? Question, how do you absolutely make sure that someone accepts your terms of use before you click on it?
Yeah, I mean, it just, do you have like a checkbox in there to check?
So it's thinking, but it's just going to be a checkbox. And we're deploying the seats back.
That works?
With that part of you.
Yeah, you can make it a required field and only give them a yes option. That's what I do.
Yeah, usually it's part of a form that they're filling out. And if you're using a form, that's what I use.
Yeah, you do a checkbox, you make it required, and only give them a yes option. They don't have a no option.
Yeah, just have a checkbox.
I just use a checkbox.
Just make a checkbox, and then it has the terms there.
I agree. Okay. It's required.
And the other question I have is, does anyone have a reason where you get
the Creative Commons. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that I was just working on a policy just now for WordCamp. Open Source Bridge. Hold on. I'll look for it. I'll email it to you. I was just working on it today. So open source bridge something, and it's terms of use type wording that are all under Creative Commons license. So I'll get you that link. All right. Any other tips, tricks, wishes, wants? Yes, Jeff.
Does anyone here have a link to chapter 4 of the book? It's
Oh, I've heard of Zapier. I've heard of Zapier. Do you use it in combination with Gravity Forms? Yes. Zapier integration is cool. Yeah, it does.
That's a help desk type functionality.
All right. February 13th is the next meetup. Can I put you on? All right. Yeah, fill out the form.
What's that?
I was also, you're Buddy Press. You do Buddy Press too, right? I may call you on Buddy Press later.
What was that one called, Carol?
Zapier.
Z-A-P-I-E-R.
Zapier. It's kind of an, I don't even know what it is. Is it an API or is it a bunch of APIs?
That's what the name's about. It's API.
Okay.
And that's, it's a bridge, basically. Connect this API to that API. It's all does is.
It bridges a lot of stuff together. It's like
all kinds of cool, amazing stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, in Gravity Forms, of course, is. Chris Lemma wrote a post about this, and I can't remember what he did with it, but he did something with Gravity Forms, Zapier, and something else. Ift, maybe.
It's a Google Docs. You can tell it, you know, somebody updates this Google Doc or creates a Google Docs and send me an email or send me a text or this or that. It doesn't really need to.
Yeah.
I use it with Asana. So
Asana.
If I have a support system, and then it goes to Asana.
Yep. That's cool. Yeah. All right. Any other tips, tricks, wishes, wants? Yes.
I was wondering if anybody has worked with WordPress with
large sites and load balancing and did that other thing.
Looking for someone who's worked with WordPress with very large sites. Didn't you say it was a 20,000 page site? Okay. And load balancing. Have not. Anyone? Anyone? Euler? Euler?
Never load balancing. What specifically do you
want to know? I mean, well, I just want, right now the site is isn't in WordPress, but I wanted to work with the developer kind of. Yeah, make a list of all the things that I want the application to do, and kind of get an idea of WordPress is going to be powerful. Because I also want custom post types and taxonomies, and right now I'm looking at Google versus WordPress.
So with the load balancer, what are you? That's not necessary to.
Well, like last year, I had 38 million unique visitors, and probably like 10 page views per average per visitor. So, I have heavy loads. And
is the website just HTML right now?
Wow.
So it's not behind any load balancer or anything.
It's not, but I'm doing kind of a pseudo load balancing. I'm having that sense on my page.
CDN.
Yeah. Once you move to Drupal or WordPress or something, that may make a lot of visitors. You don't need something, you're going to need a server that has not load balancing and stuff. But that's the beauty of HTML, is obviously. My websites that I run, they're behind a load balancer and all of that, but I pay a lot of money for server. And so if you're just doing your one site, to jump on with someone else or something, do you use like Cloudflare or something like that for your CDN? Or do you use anything like that?
Well, right now I'm using two dedicated servers.
So you're paying a lot of money.
Yeah, I'm paying a lot of money anyway. So I'm better off with them.
Yeah. I don't know if you want to talk afterwards, I can.
As far as the question, can WordPress handle that? I mean, I think WordPress can handle a lot. What are some of the? I mean, Wall Street Journal has their blog. Is that right? And that the Wall Street Journal has their blog on WordPress?
MSNBC, aren't they the one?
Is it? There's one big major, Reuters. Maybe it's Reuters. Anyway, there's a big major news outlet that uses WordPress.
New York Times blogs.
New York Times does? Okay. Okay. CNN blog does? Okay. So if you actually go to WordPress.org and you search somewhere maybe about WordPress, there's a nifty little page that shows you all the different big brands, and you would be amazed at some of the things that are running on WordPress. And WordPress can interact with different things. Not everything in WordPress is special functionality. You've got the CMS for one thing, and then it's passing off to maybe, I don't know, whatever, over here. So WordPress can do a ton. So a lot of people still have it in their mind that WordPress is just a blogging platform. It is so not just a blogging platform. It can handle a lot.
I don't know what the efficiencies are and the differences between Drupal and WordPress as far as performance-wise, but with the load that you're talking about, it's almost like WordPress isn't really there, compared to straight HTML files, anything you use is an issue compared to HTML is in its own world. There's no database, there's no PHP, no programming, nothing going on. It's just dumping stuff out. And there's no processing power for the server to handle it to a certain extent. Where in CMS, as soon as you get that into the mix, it makes life a lot more complicated. It makes it a lot better in a lot of ways, especially on the front end. But performance I think what we were talking about with using a CDN or using something like Cloudflare and using a load balancer. master and stuff and sort of you know, cache files and that kind of stuff. So that WordPress isn't basically your mobile is to make WordPress not this. But ACMS will make it not be touch and make all these other and sort of upstream HTML at CDNs or whatever it's called. All that stuff is basically what that's all you need to play and that's what I'm going to do.
That sounds like it. Yeah. No, or maybe it's just nicer.
All right, so you guys are going to talk about that maybe afterwards, kind of connect and do some more. Okay, so cool. That's awesome. All right, anything else? We've got, what time is it? We have actually about 20 minutes. So let's go ahead and move on into just kind of the, Lori's going to give us a tour of Dashum. All right, so take it away. Oh, and if you're new here, this is a show and tell. We like to do this. If you have a site you want to show off, you kind of show what you're doing, please, please, please let us know because we'd love to have people just show this is a real site and here's what it's doing.
Thanks, Karen. For those of you who come here regularly, it's kind of heard my running joke that I feel like changing my company name from Green Progress to Cousins Graphic Design because I do a lot of websites for cousins. And they're entrepreneurial, too. So the site I'm going to show you this evening is a younger cousin of mine who is a hip-hop musician in Chicago. And oddly enough, the theme that I chose was modeled after a church called Outreach. But I liked it because of the elements. And I would normally show you that best I can do. It's a Genesis theme. And they recently upgraded it with HTML5. So they yanked the other one down. So I can show you what they've updated it to. It looks like this. So it's fairly similar, but the changes that are in Outreach Pro that are visual, they have this header in the green. There's like five palettes you can choose from. Oh, excuse me, that's one, two, three, yeah, five. So, which the buttons don't work, it looks like. Okay, there's the orange. So I had chosen the orange for Dashcon. But in the older version, up here was black up at the top. That's probably the most significant difference. But there are widgeted areas, like here's the social media, that's a widget area. This slider is controlled by a plugin called Genesis Responsive Slider. And you can choose to put the message in there or not. This is linked to a post, I believe. And then these areas are widgeted, this whole center, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then this area is a widget. And then you've got your footer widgets. So you can choose to keep, you know, like eliminate these four, whatever. You can, depending on whether you put information into those areas. So I'll walk you over here to Dashcon. So this is my cousin, Darian. He's like 23 or something. And we can listen. I don't know if this will translate. I'll click on the music.
It won't
come out of my...
It won't play over the speakers. We heard it. That was good.
I can hear it.
So that's Syrian. Fortunately, he had some professional photographs taken, so I had some good photography to work with, and I really didn't know what to put in the slider, so it basically mirrors. It's kind of like eye candy for the navigation. One of the requests that he had was he wanted to be able to update his own events, and he wanted to be able to work on the back end. Previously, I should back up and say, I had done this site back in 2009 when I didn't develop anything. And I was working with a developer, and I picked a free theme off the internet, the interweb, and what a mess it was. There was a store, then there wasn't a store, blah, blah, blah. And he kept saying, I want to be able to put on my own events. And I thought, I cannot even handle the controls of this site until I clean it up. So now that I've learned quite a bit more since then, I chose this Genesis theme. So I'm going to flip back to outreach. So here they had these 1, 2, 3, 4 for leading people deeper into the site. But on the dash home one, I just didn't use those widgets just to keep it simple. There really isn't a lot of content either. Mainly he wanted his lyrics visible, and he wanted the music visible so people wanted to download it or share it with friends. So he's also, in addition to doing solo work, he's working with a band, and he has YouTube videos. So, and also speaking of the plugin that we were just talking about, the NextGen, I have NextGen in here, and there's a secondary plugin I'm still working on, see it's coming out a little wide here.
There's a CSS adjustment right there.
That's calling my name. But anyway, so you can see some of the photos I had to work with. Yes. Yeah, I was.
That's what I mean.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And also, this was basically out of the box. I virtually did no. See, other than plugins, I did no CSS customization. The only customization that you're seeing here, I messed with this widget area to alter the padding and to have it work responsively. I still have a little more work to do on this.
What plugin is that? That's the Listen Now.
Oh, that is simply the widget area. Let me show you, that's actually code from Bandcamp. So, my friend at Bandcamp.
that's what I thought.
Okay, so here's Bandcamp. That is something he introduced me to. He's the one that put his music up there. I gave him the logo, and he just built this himself in his own Bandcamp. But, for example, if you like his music and you'd like to download it, as you hover over the song and click on download, there's the share embed button, and that, of course, you can share it on social media, or you can embed this track. So then it gives me an option of what size. So I was choosing, for example, in that upper widget, the smaller one. It even tells me I can change the color. So I just grab that code, copy that,
okay.
And then let me show you how I pasted that in. So I'm going to go into the dashboard. So again, this is Genesis, and I'll walk you through this in a second here. But there are widgets under Appearance. And so this is the header right that we were looking at. And basically, I just took a simple arbitrary text or HTML widget and dragged it into this area, took that code I just copied, placed it in here, and with the help of Cliff and Chris, they were helping me adjust the measurements here a little bit so that it would work in that widget area and center nicely. But you can see the Listen Now is simply the title. So close that, so just to flash back and see that again. There it is. And so I adjusted the length of that, I believe. So the other ones, basically I took all the music song by song and chose the other size one and placed those in. I actually tweaked the orange that comes from Bandcamp so that it matched the other oranges here. So that was a simple adjustment. In fact, I think you can see that in, let's look at that in code view. So here it is in text view. I have an H3. Oh, that was just my heading. Okay. So the tracks are in order. Number one, let them hang, blah, blah, blah. And then the, let's see. Oh, here it is. That is the orange right there, the link color, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And then the size, I may have altered the size. I'm a little fuzzy on what I did there. And visually, it looks like so on the back end. And then the lyrics, so basically, let me go back to text here. The lyrics, I have a link, and that goes to a page not on the nav, just on a landing page. Let's go back to viewing this page of the solo music. If I click on the lyrics link, it'll take me to the page, and I'll put yet another one of just the song and their copyrighted lyrics. So each song has this page, but the only way you get to it is by clicking right there. Let's see, what else can I tell you? And then the videos, I essentially just took code from YouTube and pasted it right in. So, let's see. All right, I'm not going to, I think he's doing a lot of check on that one. And so the news and events is what I set up as the blog, and then I actually saw him over the holidays. We sat down and I showed him this is how you could add an event. So now he has control over every time he has a performance, he can just add that himself without having to wait for my availability to fill that in for him. And just to decorate the pages a little bit, I simply took some of the photo, this photo that was used for the slider, minus the excess of the text, and just put that at the top just to decorate the page a little bit. But going back to the home, okay, here's where a slight bit of customization. This used to have a white border. I was trying to eliminate it or change it to black, but I realized is it also controlled the background on the secondary pages. So once I changed that to black, then this page was black, which of course then it affects type here and everything.
That's where you have to really be careful and you have to get specific that only change this color on home. Or whatever. Yeah.
So I'm just starting with the CSS with Jetpack. I'll show you that on the back end. So as a compromise, I did a soft gray just so it wasn't kind of a stark white. And then for the contact, I used just a standard gravity form. I created a little thing. I had a business card for him, so I just kind of angled that in to Photoshop. And then have just the standard gravity forms. I happen to be a fan of this CAPTCHA method of preventing spam, a visual method. It's just an add-on to gravity forms that I use.
Gravity forms, is this tying to a
Oh, what great tip.
I didn't know that.
Okay.
It's just a checkbox in gravity forms? I missed that one.
Wow, okay.
You have to have, the checkbox doesn't show up in settings unless you have isn't
it enabled, okay.
So if it's enabled on the side, then you want to have a checkbox. You do that.
Oh, beautiful.
That's a good idea.
That's great. Thank you.
And I don't think I've ever had spam
gravity. Oh, I have.
From
Oh, okay. Does everyone know what a kismet is?
What's it called?
A kismet, A-K-I-S-M-E-T. It's a free plugin from WordPress.com.
It's installed by default.
Is it still? Okay.
Yeah, I don't know if it's.
It's part of Jetpack, though. It's in Jetpack.
It's in there.
Okay. So you just basically have to activate new plugins. You do have to have, you do have to have a WordPress.com account, so you have to connect it, but it's free to the WordPress.com account.
It's part of a Jetpack?
It's in Jetpack, isn't it?
No, it's part of
it. It's built into WordPress.
Yeah, it's installed automatically. So when you install WordPress and you go to plugins, it'll be there.
Yeah, exactly. Which I delete.
But it's in there.
I installed Hello Dark one time.
It is waiting free, it's not allowing the comments, but it apparently allows it back to work for people to get into this hacker site.
And is that still kind of an issue?
They're more concerned about the internet
with this thing. Not
as far as you know. That's a good question.
Thank you. Okay.
Right.
It helps everybody else on the internet.
Are comments, allowing comments, is that still a potential backdoor security risk? Allowing commenting on your on the blog?
I don't know the answer to that.
Well,
anytime I guess you give the public a space to enter something into the database, there is always going to be some danger.
And turning off comments, it might help a little bit. But most likely the bots are probably not putting anything in that form directly. They're probably submitting to the comments of page 5. So deactivating comments, that file still exists. So they're calling that file and saying, hey, here's this information, the comment stuff. But I don't know, WordPress is really good about making sure that stuff is in the comment form. And then on top of that, Kismet and
I'll show you back on the home page when we're looking at the widget areas. So here they have footer information. I ended up using, especially because of his demographics, he's getting something. Hip-hop musician, everybody's looking at this on a phone, social media. So I just use the simple social icon as large and send it, so it's nice and easy. So when you collapse this for responsive on a phone, so they just line up.
Which slider is that? Genesis responsive?
This is Genesis responsive, yeah. And I always add like a little inner shadow, just to kind of give it some depth. And the font kind of matches the more slender font in his logo that I created. So this is, you know, all part of Photoshop. This is just a little something visual to look at. So any of these are clickable to the pages that are noted. That's pretty much everything. Oh, okay, so let me show you a little more on the backend. So, if you've never worked with Genesis, when you install it, that's the framework. That gets installed, but you don't activate it. And then you choose your child theme, install that, and activate that. So, that's step one and two right there. Let's see the plugins that are used here. Okay, there's the Kismet that Jeremy was just talking about. I always use BetterWP Security. And then when I'm working with Genesis Responsive Slider, Genesis Simple Edits, I'll show you where that goes. Of course, Gravity Forms. I haven't yet tested this, but I added the MailChimp add-on because he does have a MailChimp account for social media or for a newsletter, Infinite WP for backing up the site, Jetpack, okay, so here's where the Jetpack, we were just talking about CSS with Jeremy's presentation, so once Jetpack, let's go to Jetpack for a second, so you link it with your WordPress.com account, so all the sites I work on, I link them to my WordPress.com account, not doesn't have to be affiliated with your clients. And here it is. Custom CSS is the one that I activate and configure. So where it shows up under Appearance, Edit CSS, looks like this. This is the custom CSS. And so this is the only bit of custom CSS that I've done for this site. And Chris Simon mentioned the revisions here, so if I wanted to backtrack to something I did before, if I kind of screwed it up and wanted to go backwards, I'd simply click on one of these. Let's just click to see it. And it's going to show me the differences. Here's what changed. And then I would simply say restore this version.
Oh, I didn't know this was here.
Oh, you didn't?
Okay. Where'd you go again?
Let me back here.
Is that part of a Genesis, you mean?
This is Jetpack.
This is Jetpack, so it's not...
Oh, it's for Jetpack. Okay.
So it's over here on the right, the CSS revisions.
Is that new? I wiped this out one time, and I had to restore.
Oh.
It's been in there.
Has it been in there? Oh, my gosh. It's too funny.
The only caveat is I found that sometimes you change themes.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to wipe this out, but it'll show you the revision. So you have to go to the last revision and say, revive this revision. Mm-hmm. But it's okay.
So that's pretty much it. Does anybody have any questions?
The what?
The white, the grayish white border she was trying to get rid of.
Absolutely, let's see, we'll use a little of what we learned today.